This week's parasha, Parashat Tetzaveh, is the one and only parasha from the beginning of Shemot, where Moshe Rabbeinu is born, that his name does not appear in the Torah. So all of the commentaries ask the question, why is it that there is one full sidra in the Torah that Moshe Rabbeinu's name does not appear? There are many, many different explanations, but all of the deep Hasidic explanations say that Moshe Rabbeinu in this parasha reaches a level, an existential level of being that is higher than all of the other appearances of Moshe Rabbeinu in the Torah. He reaches his ultimate and absolute source, origin of his soul, the Shorash Neshama, which is Ayin, a state of nothingness. And since in this parasha, we have to try to understand why this parasha, not any other parasha, but since in this parasha he reaches the state of Ayin, of nothingness, that's why his name does not appear explicitly in the text of the Torah. Why does he have to be in a state of Ayin in this parasha? This parasha discusses the clothing, the eight special clothings of the high priest, which is actually his brother, Aaron, Kohen Gadol. And Moshe Rabbeinu explains and describes and commands exactly how the clothings are to be made. Moshe Rabbeinu himself was not a priest all of his life. Just the 7 days of the inauguration of the tabernacle, he served as the priest before initiating his brother Aaron into the continual eternal service of the temple. In those 7 days that Moshe Rabbeinu exceptionally was the high priest, it says that he did not wear all of the clothing, the eight clothings of the high priest. He only wore one clothing, which is a white garb, a chaluk lavan, and nothing else. That white garb, and not all of the elaborate and the beautiful clothings of the priests, and especially the eight clothings of the high priest, also represents the fact that he was enclosed only in a pure, simple state of divine nothingness. So once more, why? Why? Because since Moshe Rabbeinu, this is not exactly his shlichut, his service and his function in the world to serve as the priest. That's the service of his brother, Aaron, and the descendants of his brother. So if a person, if a tzaddik, and any one of us, kulam tzaddikim, that's all, each of us has a spark of a tzaddik within us. If a tzaddik has to at some times in his life perform a service which is not his character, is not his personality, is not his particular and personal service. So in order to assume a state or a character which is not the way I am defined from my birth and the shlichut, the essential shlichut that I was given, in order to do it properly and sometimes exceptionally, I do have to assume a function and a task which is not mine. I have to return to the source of my soul, which is Ayin. And here also, since Moshe Rabbeinu has to describe and command about the clothings, and it's not his thing in essence, and the whole Torah relates to Moshe Rabbeinu. But his particular service is not this, but he has to also command this. He has to be the channel and the conduit of HaKadosh Baruch Hu for the clothings and the service of the priest. In order to become such a conduit, he himself has to reach a state of nothingness, that his name is not explicitly stated. Only the fact that Hashem is speaking to him and is commanding him to tell the children of Israel how to create the clothing for the priest. This is one of the most the deepest explanations of the fact that Moshe Rabbeinu's name is not mentioned, especially in this week's parasha, the major topic of which is to describe the clothing of the priest. From this, every one of us can learn, as we said before, that sometimes a person has to, in his life, and Hashem wants him, to do something which is not exactly, does not fit him, just like clothing. Clothing is something that fits you. It either fits you or it doesn't fit you. The clothing of the high priest did not fit Moshe Rabbeinu. That's why even if he served as a high priest, he just wore one simple white garment and nothing more than that. So sometimes a person has to assume a function which is not his. In order to assume that function, which is like to change for a certain period of time, to change one's personality, he has to be able to reach back to the source of his soul, which is nothing. Whenever there are two extremes, there's always an intermediate state between them. Between the ayin, the nothingness of the source of the soul, every soul has a source in nothingness. As it says, that ein mazal Yisrael, there is no mazal to Yisrael. Mazal is the shoresh ha-neshama, the source, the origin of the soul. The Baal Shem Tov says, read it ayin, mazal Yisrael, that every soul, its source is in the divine nothingness. Between that ultimate source of ayin and the expression of the soul and the function and the shlichut, the service of the soul in this world, which is manifest and reflected in each one of us, of our names. When a person has a name, there's something about the name that's giving to him, that the name captures within it the essence of his service and his purpose in this lifetime. So between that ayin, the nothingness that is above name, in his origin he has no name. He can assume any name. He can become anyone. He can do anything. But as soon as he's given a name, it means that he's given a certain well-defined function in life. So since these are two extremes, either nothing or name, there must be an intermediate level between them. And in Kabbalah, and Chassidut explained that that intermediate level is called Or. Or is simply light. Ayin is yet above light. Nothingness is before there's any revelation or shining of light. Even Hashem's infinite light. There's a point of absolute nothingness which is before the revelation of light. After there is light, light is pure light. But if light goes through a prism, you see a spectrum of colors. And every different soul has its spectral lines to it, its well-defined name to it, the letters that combine and permute to make his name. But between the nothingness and the name is light. So in our particular case, we'll just conclude with a very beautiful Gematria. The origin here in this week's parasha of Moshe Rabbeinu is nothing, ayin. His name, when he's given a name, it's Moshe. But in between ayin and Moshe, there is light, or. Ayin, nothing, is 61. Or is 207. Moshe is 345. So actually the numbers are getting increasing in measure. When we add these three numbers together, 61 and 207 and 345, which is Ayin and Or Moshe, the number we arrive at is 613, which is the totality of all of the commandments of the Torah, and also equals Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe our teacher and our master, our Rebbe, he equals 613, which is the all-inclusive number of the Torah. And that number reflects all of these three levels, that first he's nothing, and then that nothingness reveals infinite light. And the infinite light can assume any particular spectral pattern, and then the particular pattern that he receives, which defines his purpose in that particular lifetime, is Moshe. Moshe Rabbeinu Moses. So this is a meditation that obviously pertains to each and every one of us. That we have our name, which is our well-defined state and function in life. We have our source, which is nothing. In order to connect the nothing to the name, we have to reveal light in our soul. So may Hashem give us light, that we return to nothing, to Ayin, and then come back down into our name. As we said, sometimes in life, we have to do things which are not our thing, each one of our things, to assume another function. And that's only by returning to nothing.